Here in Omaha, the land of the College World Series, 8 flags were all raised, and now 2 have been lowered. They have been dismissed. Texas Tech and Louisville have gone home. Tonight, 1 more flag will fall. Will it be the Longhorns of Texas, who have as much College World Series experience as anyone, or the Anteaters of UC Irvine? Well, apparently it's not going to be them. They are ready for a big game here as we welcome you to ESPN's coverage of the NCAA College World Series. It's presented by Capital One. You're looking for nerves and anxiety, you have to look elsewhere. They're college kids in the end, and they don't seem to feel the stress that maybe some of their fans do who made the trek here to the heartland that is Omaha, Nebraska, for the College World Series. We begin with 8 teams. In fact, you start the tournament with 64. You're down to 8, and there are 2 brackets. The top bracket, Vanderbilt 2-0. They're in a driver's seat. Bottom bracket, so is Virginia. Tech and Louisville have lost tomorrow night at 8 Eastern. Ole Miss and TCU will do the same thing. Play in an elimination game. My boy Kyle Peterson, how you feeling after the 15 innings?
We're good.
You ready to go again?
I am. I know you are too.
I am ready to go again. We'll hear from Jess Mendoza in just a second on the 2 coaches who almost overshadow this game with 70 some odd years of experience, Mike Gillespie and Augie Garrido. We'll start with Texas. They do have all that experience. One thing they've been able to do is get on base, and in particular, one guy. And that streak came to an end, but another one's already started.
It is, yeah. Mark Payton, I mean, almost for the last 2 years, all he's done is get on base virtually every game. Came into this College World Series, reached 101 times. And when you look at Texas and the history of this program, this is the history of college baseball. The only thing that they're not first in is national titles, and they're second to USC, who had such a great one when Rod Dato was there. But for Payton, I think the one thing to watch tonight is how do you bounce back 2 days after you did something you hadn't done literally in the last 2 years, and that's reach base. 101 straight games he was on base. It's a Texas offense that plays in a ballpark just very similar to this, so they can generate manufacture runs, but Payton's a big part of it.
All right, and make no mistake about it, everybody that's watched knows we haven't had a home run yet. Runs are down. Games have been really close. A little later, we're going to talk to the man that runs the NCAA championships about all that. And as far as Irvine goes, they really have been symbolic of this whole thing. They've scored runs in 2 innings, and 2 innings only.
And won a game. One of those games, it was against the same Texas team. And for both of these teams, I think what you're going to see is just opportunistic hitting. That's what you need to push guys across. Irvine's hit 12 home runs this year, Texas 21. But the guy to really watch at the top of this lineup, who has a body and a swing and quite honestly a skill set you think could potentially find him in the big leagues, is Taylor Sparks. 6'5", 230 out of the leadoff spot. He's been hot in this NCAA tournament. For Irvine to have a chance tonight, Sparks in the leadoff spot, Spencer in the 3-hole, need to have good nights.
Yeah, Texas pitchers have said after their leadoff guy, they're kind of weak. And you ask Irvine about that, and they said they're probably right. But tonight, somebody's going to win this game. Who will it be? We'll find out.
The NCAA College World Series is presented by the Quicksilver Card from Capital One. Earn 1.5% cash back on every purchase. And in part by Golden Corral. Help yourself to happiness.
Well, you could definitely still hit home runs at Rosenblatt, especially the way it looks right now. A couple of guys that actually played there, coached there. We have more now with Jess Mendoza. Hey, Jess.
Hey, Carl. One of the most beautiful things about the College World Series is all of the knowledge that you can learn from on the field. From that aspect, you could not ask for a better matchup with Augie Garrido and Mike Gillespie. Over 5 decades of baseball knowledge, and as much as these guys don't like going head-to-head against each other, they have a ton of respect.
Mike Gillespie is one of the great coaches in college baseball.
I know Augie well. Augie and I go way, way, way back. We actually played against each other back in the day.
He played third base at USC, and I played left field for Fresno State.
He's certainly on the shortest list of the most outstanding coaches in the history of college baseball. Everybody knows that. That should be without debate.
I've always admired the success that he's had and the person that he is and what he's accomplished. He's one of those coaches that changes the lives of many of his players for the better.
To look forward to the opportunity to play him is not such a thrill, because they're tough and they're well-schooled and well-drilled and hard to beat. So we ought to be careful what we wish for there.
Without a doubt, These are definitely two of the greatest coaches of all time. This is a historic moment. You may never get to see them go head-to-head together again. But the reason why they're so good, why coaches at home want to break out their notebooks, is they combined for almost 3,000 career wins, 20 College World Series appearances, and those six national titles. I don't think it gets any better than that, Carl.
No, it doesn't. If you're into experience, there's no doubt those two guys have it. And it's funny because Garrido's coming off of a terrible year, relied on freshmen to get him back here. And Gillespie was having a terrible year, and all of a sudden the Anteaters got hot. They were one of the last teams in, and now they find themselves playing for a College World Series title. Take a look at our Capital One starting lineup for those Longhorns.
Well, Trace Barrera to me is the one guy that sticks out just because of age and position that he is for Texas. He's essentially caught the entire season as a freshman. It's right in the middle of this lineup. They'll start three freshmen offensively, and that's been a key to Texas this year, is how physical those freshmen have been, and Barrera's that guy. I mean, he looks the part back behind the plate, does not look like a freshman, and hasn't handled himself like that either. Tonight they'll face a left-hander, Evan Mannarino, and really, I think the spot tonight for Mannarino, and this is the portion of the tournament where you look and see who has the most depth. Mannarino's had a very, very good year. But the one thing that he doesn't do a lot of is there's not great swing and miss stuff. I don't know that it matters, and I think that's the key. He throws a ton of strikes, and that's the one thing to watch tonight. Good fastball, get up into the mid-80s. Curveball, slider, changeup's very good as well. Throw strikes, great command, and I think that's the key right here. Against a team in Texas that isn't going to drive it over many of the outfielders' heads, Mannarino, especially in this ballpark, can really use his defense, and that's when he's at his best.
49 strikeouts on the season for Mannarino. By comparison, we've seen Andrew Morales, their ace, 141 strikeouts. Elliot Surrey, we saw pitch the other night, 76. So the defense will be asked to catch the ball a lot. Brooks Marlowe is going to lead things off for the Longhorns, and the first pitch is a strike. And we're underway. One just misses. One of the things that Augie would tell you about his team, a lot of them are really good Division I baseball players, which said another way is there's not a lot of major league prospects on the roster. They had a handful of guys drafted, but a guy like Marlowe, he swings through that one. His dad was a high school coach. His brother is a pitcher on this team, had surgery. Just a gritty, gutty guy that knows how to play baseball and can help a team win.
There's a little thump, too. I mean, he hit a leadoff home run against Texas A&M in a regional that really was a shot in the arm of this Texas team to get everything started.
1-2 roll to first base. Easy play for Connor Spencer, and there's one man down. UC-Irvine this season fielded at a .974 clip. They made 66 errors, which was 10 less than their opponents. Up the middle, very solid. Rabago, the shortstop. Palmer, the second baseman. Sparks is the guy at third base that Kyle talked about. And this is Ben Johnson. This guy, if he gets on, can absolutely fly around the bases. Out of play. People who see Ben in the weight room rave at how much he can bench press, squat. Great high school football player. And at one point he was squatting about 525 pounds, and they basically said, that's, you know, that's good, we're done now, we don't need to go any higher than that.
that's enough plates.
On the outside corner, called strike two.
When Johnson is the guy that has a chance to be a pro prospect, just moves around a little bit different. The speed can be a game changer. 21 of 21 in stolen bases this year for Johnson.
Good pitch on the inside corner, and Johnson's retired. Nice start so far for Evan Mannarino.
You know, what we've seen with every pitcher from UC Irvine, and the Morales stuff is very good, but after that, the stuff is just okay. They're still not afraid to throw this pitch, and that's where the fastball inside. Regardless of velocity, if it moves a little bit or if that ball's in the right spot, you still have to force the hitters to respect the inside part of the plate. Mannarino, well, that one might have just missed inside. The idea is the right one to try to stay an inside corner of the plate and surprise a right-handed hitter.
Ball.
Mark Payton is the one who had the 101 straight games of reaching base. Try to get your head around that. 101. He was broken up the other night. Apparently after the game, he didn't even talk about it. Didn't want to acknowledge it. Probably was made a bigger deal by other people than it was of Mark Payton. And then he since has started a new one. If you're looking for 95, you're not going to see it here, but boy, is he working the strike zone.
Throws a ton of strikes. I mean, coming in, 8 walks in 58 innings for Mannarino, so he is going to force the other side to beat him.
This one is through, and the first hit of the game, Mark Payton, 7th round draft pick of the New York Yankees. Came back to help get this team here as a senior, and lo and behold, he's done it. Now he's on base.
How about the patience, too, to get to this point? This is how you walk 56 times over the course of the year. And I think the one thing you see with these Texas hitters is you don't mind getting deep into the count because the fear of that swing and miss slider just isn't really going to be there as much tonight. Payton recognized the spin, the head out of the bat, kept that barrel in long enough to hook it to right field for a single.
Two of the better ones there in college baseball, Payton and Connor Spencer, having a few words with each other over at first. Trespurrera, the cleanup hitter. He'll catch tonight for Augie Garrido's Longhorn team. Keep an eye on Payton, 19 steals this season. Tres looked like he was swinging for the quattro there. You'll see that a lot. Freshman. Augie Garrido relied on his freshman to help get him here. And that was a, to me, it seemed like a calculated risk and one you had to take. But given where they finished last year in the conference, to have so many freshmen play a role to try to get out of the basement.
I thought it was interesting. When you asked him the question, though, today about how you thought it would work out, he was very honest. He said, I didn't know.
Yeah.
I didn't know if it would work, but thought it gave us the best chance to be the best team that we could be. And it's been a very good run for Texas this year. But for about 3 weeks towards the end of the season, this was a club that was, at one point, a top 10 team and discussed as potentially a national seed, slipped up a little bit at the end, and then ended up hosting a regional or a super regional and knocking off Houston.
Ups and downs with a bunch of freshmen, a couple of seniors, and they got them picked off. Throw down to the shortstop covering, and it worked. And they're going to do that a lot tonight. They'll pitch out, they'll throw over to first, and hope they can nail a base runner, and they just did there as Payton is retired, caught stealing. Good inning for Evan Mannarino, and Irvine is coming up. There's not a lot of baseball jerseys at any level that say Eaters on them, but we have one here with UC Irvine. They're going to come to the plate, which means we now take a look at our Capital One starting lineup.
Well, offensively, we talked a lot about sparks, but when you ask Mike Gillespie who's your best hitter, it's Connor Spencer. That's the name that really comes up. 362, that's almost 50 points higher than anybody else on this team. And, well, he's hit just one home run. Spencer finds the barrel most times, and it's really it's Spencer and Sparks as the offense. McClanahan's had some big hits this year. He's up above 300, but watch how Spencer, especially right on left today, will use all parts of this field. Chad Hollingsworth, the sophomore right-hander on, who had a giant start, his only start of the year for Texas against Texas A&M in the regional final. Just one start on the year, but that one start, he went the distance.
First pitch, you can see that ball dive into the lower part of the strike zone, and Taylor Sparks swung and missed through it.
That's what you see. Fastball be 87 to 90. Has very good sink. Curveball primary off-speed pitch, but the changeup is good. And he, just like Mannarino, will work quick. Gets it back, gets ready to go.
Two quickies. Sparks out of Long Beach, California, the junior. Got a great baseball body, 6'4", 225.
That one didn't miss by much. That's why the Reds grabbed him in the second round. He fouls it off into the mitts of Tres Barrera. One man down. One thing about Irvine, you look at their numbers during the regular season at 271. They're 254 during the tournament. They do that probably a little bit more than they'd like to strike out.
And Sparks more than anybody. That's 70th strikeout on the year for Sparks. So two-seam fastball for Hollinsworth. It came back enough. Five pitches, five fastballs so far for Hollinsworth.
Verbago fouled that one out of play. He's the shortstop for the Anteaters. Good pitch. 13th rounder for the Rockies, the junior, 5'11", 190 pounder. Both these teams have managed to have pretty good success hitting with two strikes. Popped up, second baseman Marlowe, first baseman Clemens. It's Marlowe underneath it for the second out. Well, you can see this is one of those games, Kyle, where the pitcher is not overpowering and you kind of go back to the dugout talking to yourself a little bit if you haven't been able to square one up.
This is winning about the third inning. You start hearing guys go, how can this guy beat us? How can this guy beat us? But he just keeps doing it over and over again. And while most of Hollingsworth's work this year has been out of the bullpen, his one start was outstanding. A little different hitter, though, right here in Connor Spencer.
Yankees grabbed him in the eighth round. 6'2", 215-pound junior. And that one is in the left field. And Irvine is off the schneid. They pick up their first hit of the game.
On the first breaking ball of the game, and that one just hung up, and it was in a perfect spot for Spencer to go get it. Watch where it starts and where it ends up. Even though it's not a strike, that's the one, that hanging breaking ball that guys want to go after. And for Spencer, it shows you why you hit 360. Not trying to pull that into the gap. Just go with it. Spencer on there with a two-out single.
Jerry McClanahan is the catcher. That pitch fastball rises out of the zone at 86 miles an hour. McClanahan will make it a little tough on Hollingsworth. He is very patient. Senior. Looks at that pitch for a strike. Should say a fourth year junior, actually. He's not a senior, he's a fourth year junior.
Kind reminder from Tony Walsh, the home plate umpire. You heard in the background there, don't throw your elbow back into it now.
Center field carrying to right center, but underneath it is Payton. Both sides get a hit, but no runs. Took just shy of 5 hours, ended at midnight with Virginia beating TCU. And what's at stake tonight? Texas and UC Irvine. The winner will get Vanderbilt. Not something you really want to think about, but better off playing them than going home. That's the headlines of the week. Louisville and Texas Tech were the first teams eliminated. Louisville, for the second consecutive year, comes and quickly goes 0-2. Ole Miss, TCU elimination game Thursday. You'll see it 8 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN. 30 of the last 33 College World Series champions start at 2-0, which is why that last night's game, 15 innings, was so, so important. Tres Barrera back up after a caught stealing, and he flies to the infield. It's caught over there by Grant Palmer. Not often you're a part of a 15-inning game that lasts almost 5 hours. It actually seemed to, I enjoyed it more as it went on.
I agree.
Pitchers were unbelievable, but so were the attitude of the people in the stands. And
it was a bunch here at the end, too.
Yeah,
I was impressed.
Sure was.
Oh, I mean, you not every day in a college game you get four guys that come out throwing 95 or more. It was, the arms on both sides were outstanding.
And both those teams still alive. Virginia 2-0. TCU goes to 1-1, so they'll again play tomorrow night. CJ Hinojosa, the shortstop, having a great NCAA tournament. You see the numbers there, hitting .414. Looks at a called strike.
He was talking to Booney today about Riley Farrell, the closer for TCU, and he said exactly what I was thinking, is only a sophomore next year. I mean, that's a kid that could be in the big leagues next September. Somebody right. Draft him and push him, because there's just not much you need to do. He is really good.
Aaron Boone, John Shombe, Jamie Sawyer have been calling the games during the day. They'll be here tomorrow night at 8 o'clock. Peterson basically went into the management and said, I need a night. After the 15 innings, I need a break.
No.
So, no, it's okay.
No, I'm here tomorrow night, too.
Oh, you're here tomorrow night.
Oh, yeah.
There's the play, Palmer. So you went in, they didn't listen.
No, they threw me out. I went in and they told me to leave. The backhand play right there by Grant Palmer, too, and both of these teams can really show you elite defense. When they get to it, they're usually going to make the play. Palmer going backhand side, just four errors all year for Grant Palmer, and he shows you why right there. I love that move, especially by a second baseman. Plenty of time to set that right foot strong throw across for the second out.
Slide, get low. That way, even if it goes off your glove, it's going to stay in front of you. By Colin Shaw, the right fielder. Lifts this one to shallow left, giving chase is Rabago, the shortstop. Nobody's going to get it. Look out, he and the left fielder, Adam Alcantara. The closest to it. Rabago is aggressive out there. He's got a big arm. He actually tweaked his shoulder. Apparently projects as a catcher at the next level, but he dove into second base about a month ago, tweaked that shoulder. He's playing with some discomfort there. And obviously the idea that you're going to project out to be a catcher means you've got to have a cannon for an arm, be behind the plate to throw out runners at second. And it's just starting to get back to full strength.
Ball. It's pretty good athleticism, though, if you're playing shortstop at this point and they say, you know what, we think at some point he's going to project as a catcher. A lot of guys who could do both of those.
Hit on the nose. That one is not going to be caught by Palmer. Sometimes the breaking ball early here has been left up in the zone, and the Texas hitters have taken advantage of it.
And recognized it early. We saw it with Mark Payton in the first inning, the exact same thing with Colin Shaw right here. Watch the weight, how the weight stays back, which means he's seeing that spin nice and early. Bubble, and the breaking ball comes right back into the hitting zone. Two hits for Texas, but both have been with two outs. Payton in the first, and now Shaw here in the second.
And both singles, and make no mistake about it, singles, as long as they're spread out, won't hurt you as a defensive team. Extra base hits hard to come by here in Omaha at TD Ameritrade. Madison Carter's the designated hitter. Throw over to make sure Shaw stays put. He's got 13 steals on the year. For a strike. Had good numbers during the regular season. One thing Augie Garrido did was, after he inserted Madison Carter into the lineup March 30th, he basically has left him there ever since.
Well, double.
We talked about it a couple nights ago, Kyle. It's not easy to do, to have a consistent lineup. And Augie, in spite of the ups, and there were a lot of them, the occasional down, he wasn't changing anything.
Now they have eight of the nine guys in this lineup, they've had at least 53 starts this year. So by and large, this is what you've seen. Carter really the only difference. But since he's been put into the lineup, he's stayed there.
0-2, throw over the first. Nothing doing there. How difficult a role you think being a DH is in college, where you know, clearly you'd want to play in the field. I would imagine most do. It's not like you're getting paid. It's not like you can hit the ball over the wall.
Yeah, I mean, at least you're in the lineup.
You are.
That's the good part.
Oh, two. He chased it. Three outs, and two of them via the strikeout. Look at Omaha. Temperature down a little bit. Beautiful night for baseball, and we are heading to the bottom of the second. The high jump.
Scoreless in Omaha as we head to the bottom of the second inning between Texas and UC Irvine, an elimination game. Winner will get Vanderbilt on Friday night. You know, it's been a tough few days here in Nebraska due to weather just north of here, about 100 miles north in Pilger, Nebraska. Monday's tornado took the lives of two people. Motorist David Herat, 74 years old, of Clarkson, Nebraska, died in Cumming County, just a few miles east of Pilger. His son Doug, is an Omaha police officer, was actually here at TD Ameritrade working when it happened. 5-year-old Callista Dixon also lost her life. The terrible destruction for Pilger that amazingly is about an hour and 45 minutes from where we sit. It's been a rough few days in the northeast part of this state.
You know, an hour and 45 minutes away, and we didn't have any of that weather here. And it's something you deal with as an Omaha native, and you've been dealing with your entire life. Terrible, terrible images. Jonathan Munoz has looked at that one. It's in there for a strike. He fouled the first pitch off. The pattern early here is that these pitchers get ahead of you. Munoz only 4 for 29 in this NCAA tournament. Third base, smothered over there. Zake Gerwitz across, and one man up, one man down.
Freshman to freshman right there. Gerwitz, the freshman third baseman. Casey Clemens over at first. Gerwitz and Clemens, although down towards the bottom of the lineup. Two of the three freshmen that have had a huge impact. And Clemens, the first baseman, a lot of that has been defensively. He is outstanding with the glove over at first.
First pitch, swing and a miss. Grant Palmer, and yes, that is the son of Roger Clemens. Casey Clemens over there at first base. And a very good chance you'll see him pitch next year. They like his stuff. And compare him to his dad and his demeanor on the mound.
Ball.
Of course, Roger played for the Longhorns, College World Series. He was here earlier this week.
Ball.
Been to so many of these Longhorn games. And there he is again tonight. Avid supporter of his son, obviously, in this Longhorn program. Casey's built a little bit like his dad. Thick, tall, strong.
And I think we're going to see Casey on the mound next year.
Yeah.
Had some shoulder issues that have limited him just to offensive and playing first base this year, so has not pitched at all. But they expect some very good things from Casey when they get him on the mound next year, and potentially pitch some this summer too to get ready for next year.
Be interesting to face a Texas team with a guy named Clemens on the mound. Just the concept.
I mean, obviously, what he accomplished in the big leagues, but still, I remember watching him when Texas came here. I mean, they were, saw 35 times they've been here to Omaha. I mean, you pick a decade, and they're here almost every other year.
3-2, shallow, right center. Coming in is Colin Shaw. He's under it and makes the play. I mean, moving forward, a lot of these kids that are heading towards college now certainly know of what Roger did in the major leagues, and they'll be like, oh, yeah, I faced Clemens in college, too.
I'll just leave it at that.
Just leave it there.
Hey, never know, never know.
Casey's leading off for the Longhorns when they come to the plate. Chris Paulino's the right fielder for Irvine.
Both these guys been as advertised so far. I mean,
yeah.
Get it, throw it over the plate, filling up the zone, giving up a few hits, but just three singles so far. It's
hard on the ground. This is going to be a tough, tough play. It was going to be tough to begin with, and when Marlowe couldn't field it, didn't have to worry whether Hollingsworth was going to get over there in time.
See if they call this one a hit or an error. I think Paulino might have beat it out anyway. You can see how deep Marlowe has to go to make that play. Hollingsworth looked like had a chance to get over to first base in time. But all the base runners so far in this game, two for Texas and two for Irvine, have come with two outs in each of the first two innings, and that will go as a single.
Two outs, two strike hits. Be a big key tonight. Adam Alcantara, fly ball right field to the seats it's going to go, and out of play.
Take a time for a move. Sometimes it's not how good your move is, but when you spin to go over to first base, and Hollingsworth that time, he got it right in the spot where the base runners usually taking their lead. And if you catch a guy in between steps to where the left foot is going out to catch the right foot, that's where sometimes, even if the lead isn't that big, you can catch a guy just with the wrong footing.
No extra base hits for Alcantara here in the tournament. He fouls that one out of play. Extra base hits have been hard to come by since TD Ameritrade opened in 2011, and this year we've hit an historic low so far. We have not had one home run hit. We look forward to being joined in the third inning by a man who's kind of in the middle of all those conversations. His name's Damani Leach. He's the NCAA Director of Championships. And like the viewer at home and the fan in the stands, a lot of questions, and looking forward to hearing what Damani has to say about the dialogue that's taking place behind the scenes and what, if anything, they'd like to see change.
Had to grab the new baseball for the first time, so they've got the new baseball with the lower seams that have now been produced. They'll get put into play next year. And all of the tests indicate that this ball is going to go further, and in some cases up to 10% further. That's a big difference, and it's a needed difference.
1-2, that one up in the zone. He fouls it down the line and right. Chris Paulino is moving. There's a number of variables that the folks involved with the College World Series can control. There's a number that they can't, and the wind is one of those. And the wind routinely blows in from center field, which it's doing again tonight.
Ball.
1-2 out of the zone. Throw down, though, and a good throw. Trace Barrera threw it down. Paulino almost looked like he was waiting for some contact.
But the arm for the freshman, Barrera. So back-to-back pitches Paulino was going. The first is fouled off, but this time plenty of time for Barrera. A little breaking ball, takes no steps, just sets that right foot. Great throw out to Brooks Moreland. Two in the books, still scoreless in Omaha.
Little flashback here, and that shot off the bat of Hunter Renfroe cleared the wall. Been a while since we've seen one of those, and if you're looking for exact time frames, 111 innings since he went deep for Mississippi State. That was in game 11 of 2013. Take a look at the home runs by year. And of course, Rosenblatt there in the dark red, 45-32, 9-10-3, and this year, the bottom line, no home runs. And it's certainly been a topic of conversation, and delighted to be joined by Damani Leach, who is the head of the NCAA championships here, obviously baseball. Welcome. It's a really a pleasure to have you here.
Yeah, absolutely. Good to be here.
And we'll pick things up here as the third inning is about to begin for the Longhorns. We talked about Roger Clemens' son. Casey's going to be the first to hit. And let's get the feel for what you have been experiencing since this College World Series started. What's the dialogue been like?
You know, I think it's been two things. Yep. I think on the one hand, great baseball, great crowds, particularly given the heat and early on, some of the iffy weather we had. To be able to sustain the crowds we've had has been great. Obviously, we all want to see home runs. I'm still holding out hope. It's early in this game. I'm holding out hope we'll get one tonight.
There's a good pitch into Casey Clemens. Clemens has struck out seven times, hasn't got a walk yet. And Mannarino again working quickly. That one's fouled back.
Monty, we started to talk right before you came on just about the new baseball, and it's the first time we felt it, which is good because I think it's going to make a difference. We've talked plenty about ballpark and style of game and the bats and everything else, but what do you think this change, which comes in next year, how much do you think this changes?
Yep. So we did testing in a lab. We did some field testing as well. And what we found is that on average, a home run ball, 340-foot ball, is going to travel 20 feet farther. So we think that'll add some distance to home run balls, but then also just kind of spread out the game. Right. You know, I think you see where the outfielders are positioned during the College World Series. I think you'd like to see them push back a little bit. So some of those good shots are singles and not outs.
We had kind of a perfect storm with the bats change and new ballpark and obviously home plate moves 90 degrees, which made a difference. Yep. What did you guys expect when you came in? What did you think you were going to see with all those changes?
Right. I think we certainly knew there was going to be an impact on offense. That's why we changed the bats. We didn't anticipate the impact of the orientation of the field and how significant that was going to be in terms of offensive performance. I think that's been the biggest surprise.
Zane Gerwitz comes up after Clemens struck out. He fouls that one off. So the proactive part of this is, hey, we have a new baseball coming next year. And you've heard and acknowledge yourself you want to see more home runs. Mm-hmm. Let's assume that the baseball changes it to a degree. What kind of degree do you want to see it change to so that then you can say, this is the last thing we're going to do, or you know what? We need to do a little bit more. That's a fair ball. And now the home plate umpire overrules the third base umpire and says foul ball. So let's say the ball creates a couple of home runs. What is sort of the guidelines that you want to see in play?
Right. I think that's the conversation that's happening throughout the baseball community. I think everybody says they want to see balance in the game, offense and defensive balance. But what does that mean? A little bit of it is you know it when you see it, when you arrive there. And I think once we get the new ball in place, we'll see how it plays, what's the impact nationally, not just here in Omaha, and make a decision about whether or not there are other things that we need to change.
And one of the challenges I would imagine you guys all face is that if they hit home runs at Irvine, if they're hitting home runs at Texas with the new baseball, another strikeout there, will that translate here? Because it seems like the dialogue is this place is very different than the ballparks, irrespective of the dimensions, which may be the same, but you touched on it. The way it faces out, the wind blowing in, that even if the baseball works away from here, it may not be enough here.
Right. I think what we've seen over the last 3 years is nationally there's been a decline in offensive performance, but it's been more pronounced here in Omaha. So we certainly recognize that and notice that, and that's when you start looking at other things. I think we talk about the fences as something you can look at. We'll certainly look at it, but that's not an easy solution. I mean, that's a real significant physical change to the ballpark.
But I think it's important that you're open to it if necessary.
Very much. Very much. We had a meeting this morning and talked about it.
Good.
How about the other side? Because we seem to all want to have the game succeed and have the possibility of a home run in the seventh inning as much as you do in the 14th inning. Is there another side of the coin where it's, hey, we're good with this. Let's not change it. Let's leave it where it's at.
Yeah. And that's part of it. I mean, the pitching that we've seen here has been phenomenal,
right?
Particularly the last few years. I mean, it's just been great, great pitching, great situational hitting, you know, great baseball in general. So we don't want to go too far. I think general consensus is late 90s baseball offense was just way out of whack. So how do we move it back slightly without too much? We're hoping the seams will do that.
All right. Demonte's going to hang here with us. We'll get into some of the things that are being talked about as another very good inning from Evan Mannarino. College World Series 0-0.
Yeah, I mean, it was, you know, premium arms. It's hard to get upset at your offense when you're facing that kind of pitching, and especially in a I got to be careful here before I say some things about this ballpark that I'll regret, but it's just a travesty what we've done to college baseball.
And we continue our conversation with Damani Leach, the chairman of the NCAA championships. Your thoughts on what Jim Schlossnagel, the head coach at TCU, said there?
Yeah, well, obviously he was frustrated. He and I actually talked earlier today, and what I wanted to let him know was that we heard him. We understand his frustration, and you know, we're listening to him. We care about the game of baseball. We care about this event and what it means to the players and to the community, and we're doing what we can. We've already taken steps with the ball, and we'll keep working on it.
You know, I give you credit too, because it's not I mean, we were pretty hard on it last night, and there is an element of frustration to it, because game looks very different than it looked before, and there's a part of it, we've talked about this internally, is, you know, you want the best athletes to get to college.
Right.
And what you don't want is for, and it's not a knock on professional baseball, they have a job to do too, but you don't want them to use this as another tool to try to get kids to sign out of high school. But I'm glad that it's being looked at as seriously as it is. The ball's a big deal, but I think it's good for all of us to hear from you.
Yeah.
That, yes, we're thinking about the stadium too. Let's see what it looks like. I think it's great. But the fact that the stadium talk has been come up, because this place is different. It's beautiful.
Right.
But it's different. Right. It plays very different. It's good to hear.
Yeah. I think everything has to be on the table.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's the only way you can handle a situation like this.
Second attempted bunks from Castro. His foul. We talked last night about Comerica Park. They did it at the major league level.
Right.
There are obvious financial considerations when a decision like that is made. The criticism that I'm sure you've heard, rightly or wrongly, about the NCAA is that it just takes so long to get something to happen.
Right.
Are you looking at a window in which you say this has to happen within X amount of time, because we lose fans, we may lose viewers, the game's popularity may wane?
Right. So there's certainly, the ball is going to change next year, and we want to give that time. We want to let that breathe and see how that impacts the game nationally as well as here in Omaha. How long that takes, you know, one or two seasons, I think we need to see. But certainly we're going to pay attention to how many butts are in the seat, how many people are watching the game throughout the year as well as during the College World Series. We definitely don't want to lose track of that. Those are all very important things.
Here are the balls. The one on the left, the newer ball, you can see the seams lower. The one on the right of the screen have the raised seams, which are what we're using now, and that all has to do with aerodynamics, and the ball has less resistance against it, and it travels through the air.
The other thing too that's good is this ball is similar. When these kids go play pro ball, it's similar to the next one they're going to grab,
because
I mean, you could never have played the game of baseball. If you pick up the current baseball and the one that you're using next, you can tell immediately what the difference is.
The coaches bring up integrity, meaning we got here because we fielded well, we pitched well, we also hit home runs, and in this ballpark it is virtually impossible. So as a result, the things that help make us successful, the things that give us a competitive advantage, are in a sense eliminated on a ball field like this, understanding all teams were affected the same way. But still, you're coming here, and a lot of people point to UCLA last year and say, well, they won because they were very good, but because they played a style that fits this field as opposed to another team that can hit a ball over the wall.
Right, yeah. I mean, certainly we want to see home runs. I think that's an important aspect of the game. That being said, you look at the teams that are here statistically, I mean, these are the best pitching teams in the country, and I think only one of them is in the top 50 in home runs. So this is not an Omaha issue. This is not a localized issue. These are the best pitching teams in the country. They didn't get here hitting home runs.
Little butcher boy squared to bunt, fouled that one off. Your point about pitching, good pitching regardless of guys that have hit, because we've seen it at every level. Good pitching no matter what kind of bat a hitter has.
Yeah.
That guy's going to get him out anyway.
Yeah.
To your point, I agree with you. It's not only an Omaha issue, but I hope that what the ball does is it does bring that balance back.
Yes.
Because whether it's here or anywhere else, clearly the game changed visibly 4 years ago.
Right.
You know, and home run's a good thing. Not a ton of them.
Exactly.
I mean, this is from a guy. I didn't really like it.
Home runs, when apple pie, that's all good stuff.
Come on.
Here are some of the numbers from Rosenblatt to TD Ameritrade. And obviously, all the numbers on the right, a lot less than what they are on the left. You must hear from so many different factions of what is the ideal? Like, we're looking for 2.3 home runs a game. Well, I'd like to see four. I don't want to see any.
Right.
You have to kind of balance all those voices.
It is,
you?
And that's a question you have to ask just about everybody. I know Wayne Graham at Rice was pretty vocal about where he thinks the game is, and you know, we heard Coach Schlossnagel's comments from last night. I mean, I think we want to hear that, and we want to hear where people think the game should be. You know, I think just a couple weeks, the Big Ten was here. They hit 5 home runs in 13 games. So that was in this park with these bats and these balls. So trying to figure out what's the issue and how do we solve it is our task.
This is Taylor Sparks. He's the leadoff hitter for UC Irvine. Overall, let's talk about then beyond the ballpark, because you don't want to focus solely on that, college baseball.
Yeah.
How do you all feel about where it's at?
Great. Feel really, really good about it. I think our responsibility is the championship, but we understand there's a trickle-down effect on college baseball more broadly. And, you know, the coverage that you guys have given it, Kyle's all over the country all season long, has been tremendous. And people are watching it. People are supporting it. You know, the investment that universities are making on campus with their stadiums and facilities has been tremendous. We're seeing it all over the country.
You know, Kyle and I do Little League World Series. I, of course, work with the major leaguers. They have instant replay at both of those levels. Is that another thing that's being discussed? And if so, when do you think we could see expanded use of it here?
Right. Possibly as early as next season. So we did a test during Super Regionals at NCAA headquarters, used some technology to see how that might work.
This one is ripped to right center with some carry on it. Peyton going back. It's going to get... Oh, what a catch! Another outstanding play by a center fielder. Mark Peyton runs it down.
How about the plays we've seen in center field just the last two nights? I mean, two game changers last night that ended up in this one off the bat. You don't think there's any chance that Peyton's going to get there. Wind held it up just enough. That is a heck of a defensive play.
Outstanding play by Mark Peyton. Hey, you got a ball with seams that are lower. That may leave the building.
Yep. Yeah, and the reality is timing's wonderful.
Yeah.
That's the one. That's the one.
Yep.
The one from, I mean, you got a kid who's a high draft pick with big time power. That's the one that you think ought to go over somebody's head. Does it always go in the seats? Not necessarily, but have enough carry to get. It's a heck of a defensive play, not taking anything away from Peyton. But that's the one, and that's the one I look forward to seeing next.
Yeah, I think you're right. You put 20 feet on that, and that changes that play. He's not catching that with 20 more feet.
Ball.
Big time play, because that showed the power of Sparks. That wasn't a pull. That was to right center, and all home run hitters, when they're going good, they'll hit it that way. We've seen it with Pujols, Cabrera at the major league level. And he wasn't like Crone from last night, who was clearly frustrated because he thought he had a home run. Come on, we appreciate you being with us. We're excited about the open-mindedness to it.
Appreciate it.
Thanks for coming, man.
Thanks, man.
How about this defense out in center field? Mark Peyton getting it done. Defensively dives. Get it to center field. It's going to be an out with that guy out there. We'll see him offensively. The guy that hit in 101 straight games over the last 2 years. Due up next.
Fields of Omaha, as we welcome you back to ESPN's coverage of the NCAA College World Series. It's presented by Capital One. Green grass all over the place. Texas and UC Irvine. We have completed 3. We go to the top of the 4th. A perfect night for an ice cream, a milkshake, a hamburger. Destos is running hot right now, and so is the NCAA College World Series. Vanderbilt and Virginia 2-0. The 1-1 teams are all meeting Texas and Irvine right now. Tomorrow at 8 Eastern time, Ole Miss and TCU. It has ended for Louisville and Texas Tech. Just saw a dynamite defensive play in the outfield by Mark Peyton. He's on deck. Ben Johnson leads things off for Texas. And a good chance for us to kind of talk about some of the things that Damani Leach, the chairman of the NCAA championships, shared with us. And first and foremost, the fact that he came up, talked about it, seemed open-minded.
Absolutely.
was I think, refreshing for a lot of people.
I thought it was great, and I think it's just good for everybody to hear from Damani as to what's going on, because if it's behind the scenes and it's not talked about, you don't know what's going on. You have no idea. Right. It's better just to.
And the pessimists would assume, well, they're not listening.
Absolutely.
They don't care.
Absolutely.
So that was enlightening, refreshing. The baseball could very well have made a difference on the Sparks. Deep fly to right. And at one point, maybe there was, do you think, a little less willingness to consider some of these things?
Of course.
Yeah, and, I think in part because they put a lot of time and effort and money into what you're looking at. So, yeah, I mean, you want it to work.
Right.
Hunter Spencer goes back and makes that play. Not as good as this one. Our pick-you-up moment of the game brought to you by Enterprise Rent-A-Car.
Center field today, going to get a lot of balls down. Watch how far Peyton has to go for this one, where he starts, where he ends up, and whose bat it came off of. Taylor Sparks, the best raw power in this entire game, drives out to right center, but not deep enough because that guy just ran it down.
Did you notice what Colin Shaw was doing when he was watching that catch be made?
He had fist pumping.
He was pumping.
What a great.
Good job, Mark. Way to get that one for us. That was beautiful. Tell you what, you got a web jam reel of catches by center fielders.
Just the last two nights.
Unbelievable.
Uh-oh. Banner's back.
Already a SportsCenter top 10 nominee. And that'd be a pretty good reel to put together. The center field plays have been made here at TD Ameritrade. It's a big cavernous outfield, too, especially in center.
The other thing I like about what Damani did is that he and Jim Schlossnagle talked today.
Yep.
Because, I mean, you could see, and it's not just Jim Schlossnagle. I mean, there are head coaches, assistant coaches in a very large majority across the country that are saying something really needs to change. The ball, obviously, a piece of it. The ballpark is another potential piece of it. I just like the fact that they spoke. Because it's, I mean, we were frustrated.
Sure.
I mean, you're frustrated when you watch it just because there's a certain product that you want to see. And hopefully this next change is enough.
Please join the conversation at ESPNU, hashtag CWS. Get your thoughts on home runs. There's a very, very small group of people who say, well, this is baseball at its purest, and we like pitching and defense. Not even sure we're dying for the home run. What you want is the possibility. You want the hope.
You want the game to be played the way it's intended to be played.
And home runs are part of baseball.
Absolutely.
Have been since the beginning. And it just hasn't been part of the fabric at TD Ameritrade at all this year. Two men down in the fourth. Tres Barrera, catcher tonight, threw out a would-be base dealer, showed that he's got a huge arm. I think the other thing that's happened too, Kyle, is we talk about the ball and the ballpark. But if you look at the guys that have hit the ball to places where you think they would be home runs, Crone last night, Pappy, and tonight Sparks, those are really the best hitters here. So the best hitters here are the ones that are hitting the ball the hardest and the furthest, and there's nothing to show for it. And I think that's where you want them to be able to do what they do, which is occasionally hit a ball over the fence.
Absolutely. By the way, Evan Manarino is cruising right now. Just cruising.
Two hits for each team, and it is a style reminiscent of Jamie Moyer, Tommy John. It doesn't appear to be a lot of stress. You rock, and you throw.
I'll tell you this. I mean, if there's a good that's come out of the bats and the game kind of deadening, it's that guys have got back to throwing the fastball. Because you don't fear contact the way that you used to fear contact. The game for a while was just to try to make a miss everything. And I think that's one of the reasons why it was taking so long. Guys are throwing more fastballs now, and that's a good thing. Because if you're going to advance and go on and play into professional baseball, you better know how to locate the fastball and throw the pitch.
Mm-hmm. Manarino and Hollingsworth in a good pitcher's duel tonight. And these are not the ones and twos. These are the threes, and in some cases, guys that have pitched more out of the bullpen than start.
Ball four.
Oof, close pitch there. First walk of the night that has been issued by Evan Manarino.
Tony Walsh behind the plate. One of the more seasoned. All these guys are seasoned. They're going to end up at this spot. Tony's a good one.
CJ Hinojosa, who's the shortstop, moved up in the order a little bit, hitting 414 coming into the College World Series. Breaking ball in there for a strike.
Horns always travel. When Texas is here, you're going to see plenty of burnt orange in the ballpark all around.
First time at the College World Series, there were actually three teams from the state of Texas: Texas Tech, TCU, and the Longhorns.
Time call, time, time, time.
One thing Texas does really well, and part of the reason is the guy at the plate, Hinojosa, they turn a lot of double plays. First in the Big 12, tied for fourth in the nation. Mikey Garrido loves the security that Hinojosa at shortstop and Marlowe at second base provide.
Oh.
Yeah, Hinojosa, really highly touted guy when he came out of high school, played for Team USA last year. Flashing his bat at the shortstop position. Moving on, I don't think he stays at short. He's probably gonna have to move somewhere else, but pretty skilled guy.
The wind is not howling like it did last night, and as a result, you're seeing the outfielders playing at a much more sort of respectable depth than we're used to seeing. Certainly in left, even in right, center field always looks like it's crowded, but more of a conventional outfield positioning tonight. This one to right, and Paulino positioned perfectly for the out. June 18th, and young and old enjoying a College World Series, enjoying a snow cone, some ice creams. Got a beach ball working it here. Temperatures have moderated considerably. Last night it was 100 for most of the night. Now it feels like it's in the low 80s. Shades off. Sun has gone down. We got ourselves a 0-0 game in the bottom of the fourth, elimination style. Ground ball to the second baseman.
He's out.
One man up, and quickly Connor Spencer retired.
We talked about the job that Mannarino has done. Hollinsworth has done the exact same thing. Both have allowed just two hits up to this point, and both have done it primarily with a fastball. Mannarino's gone to the breaking ball just a little bit more, but Hollinsworth has been 85% fastball.
Talk about the perfect storm. The concept is if you have teams that aren't great hitting and you get strike throwers, this is where you trust your fielders, because the ball's not going to go over the wall, so let them put the ball in play. 0-2. Offered the breaking ball, but he held back. Hollingsworth had that complete game. One start against A&M back on the 2nd of June. His other longest appearance was 4 2/3. Other than that, it's all been three-inning appearances. But phenomenal numbers in 24 appearances, a .136 ERA. You like that one? Called strike three. He's got three strikeouts, Kyle.
Yeah, and he's showing you tonight, too, that you don't need to do it with velocity. We've seen a few guys do this. It's you can control both sides of the plate with a fastball, a little two-seamer that'll come back on the outside part. But for the vast majority of the outs that Hollingsworth has gotten tonight, it's really been on the fastball. Throw it for a strike early, then try to expand the zone a little bit later. And that That's not an easy one to make. That little two-seamer that starts, comes back over. The last time a four-seamer that just stayed there. Both of these guys throwing fastball to both sides of the plate.
Part of the frustration for the coaches comes when games are 0-0. It's in the fourth. It gets to the seventh. It's still 0-0. Some of the guys then try to do more than they really should be doing. Yeah. And you got to guard against that. Ripped, just foul. In the end, there's a lot of smart people who understand what a baseball game should look like, and I'm sure in time, given the relationship that the NCAA has with this ballpark, the people of Omaha, they understand the significance, the history here. They'll get it right. They will get it right.
I'm encouraged by what's happened over the last day. I am very encouraged by it. I mean, we'll see. The results will be very, very.
You can't hide it.
Apparent, which is a good thing.
Yeah.
I mean, we'll know right away.
It's just still such a cool event, and when you bring that part of it back, it would return it to the last year of Rosenblatt.
Wow.
How about that?
Got that one too ready.
Two strikeouts in the inning, four in the game. We're through four, not a shock. The score is 0-0. One thing about no home runs is most games are close. And this is one of them. Mike Gillespie will join Jess Mendoza when we come back.
Welcome back for a beautiful night for some baseball, TD Ameritrade Park. We are still scoreless through four, and I'm here with UC Irvine head coach Mike Gillespie. Coach, how do you guys get on the board?
Well, we got to get that center fielder out of the game, that's for sure. I mean, that was Mike Trout. We'll see that on ESPN later tonight, I think.
We definitely will. What else do you guys need to do?
Well, we've got to get the barrel to the ball. I mean, Hollingsworth has done a good job of spotting his fastball, and we just haven't got many good swings on him. We certainly got to find a way to get that barrel of the ball.
Well, not a lot of good swings on the flip side because of Evan Mannarino. What's allowed him to be so effective?
Well, we're really pleased with him. I think he's done a great job. This is as good as he can do. He's mixed all three of his pitches, and he's given us a chance, that's for sure.
All right, thanks a lot, Coach.
Hey, Ryan, I want to say good night to my kids, Cooper and Samantha, my grandkids. Stay with us. We'll get a run.
All right. Love it. Thank you.
All right. Good night, kids.
Don't go to bed quite yet, though.
No. Last night was the night a lot of people probably went to sleep, and then they woke up and said, what happened in that game? 15 innings. Virginia finally beat TCU. This ball is driven deep to right field, but not deep enough. And it's caught out there by Chris Paulino. Getting the barrel to the ball. That's sort of a new concept tonight for UC Irvine. Jess is one of the great hitters of all time in softball, and any baseball player that's tried to hit a softball, they really struggle getting the bat to the ball. Jess, is there anything that you're seeing down there in a reason why they're not getting the bat to the ball?
I think they are just some good defensive plays, but the small ball is really what these two teams are known for. So I think that's what they're going to get to is more of the bat to the ball in a deadening sort of way instead of trying to hit it over everyone's head.
You never probably went into any prolonged slumps, but when you did, how did you get out of it? How did you square the ball up more often?
Honestly, seeing it, just being able to see the ball deep, and a lot of times when you short game it, that's what helps. And then all of a sudden the bat gets the ball a lot easier.
He's out. Chris Rabago makes that out. Jess is going to join us on baseball tonight on a couple of Monday nights. We're looking forward to that. A superstar at Stanford, four-time first team All-American, a Pac-10 Player of the Year in 2000, College World Series 2001, USA, Olympics, anything that any woman has ever accomplished in softball.
She could do it all.
Jess has done at a higher level.
She could do it all, and I love listening to her talk hitting, too. It's great that she's going to be on baseball tonight. It's an outstanding addition.
The Mendoza-Kruk combination.
Yes.
This one to center field. That one was squared up.
I want to see Krucky try to hit a softball again. That was good to see.
He was never comfortable doing that. Comfortable for the Clemens family as Casey finally delivers a hit. He's been struggling, and he laced that one in the center field.
We've seen early swings by both of these clubs. If they get something early in the count, they've been very aggressive. This time, Casey Clemens, a little fastball that had some cut away from it. Fastball's cutting away from the left-handed hitter. Just used the middle of the field, barreled up. It's another two-out single for Texas.
I was going to say, there have been a number of that. All four base runners for Texas have come with two outs.
I think that's part of it, too. I mean, both these teams like the get them on, get them over, get them in. But if you're getting them on with two outs, it limits the things that you can do on both benches.
Absolutely. Zane Gerwitz, the number nine hitter.
Ball.
That one in the dirt. Clemens not a big threat to steal down there. And it's the other part of the lack of home runs that has had a light shined on it, and that's the running game. Try to get into scoring position. Center field, couple of steps back for Castro, and he's there and under it and takes one away from Zane Gerwitz. All right, Mike Gillespie first, Augie Garrido when we come back. Talking baseball with Jess Mendoza.
Back here in Omaha, we're still scoreless as we head into the bottom of the fifth, and I'm here with Texas head coach Augie Garrido. Now, coach, how do you feel Chad Hollingsworth done so far tonight?
He's done a really good job. He's throwing strikes, getting ahead on the count. He doesn't have overpowering velocity, but he's mixing his pitches very well.
All your base runners tonight getting on with two outs. How do you get the base runners on earlier on in the inning?
We're going to try a trick and get our leadoff hitter on next inning. What do you think about that plan?
I think it's a great plan. I like it. How do you do that?
By prayer. Prayer helps a lot.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Yes. The beauty of Garrido
is
back. they'll tell you exactly how it is. They are tremendously accountable for the programs that they have and the players they have, the realistic expectations. They've seen everything.
Yeah.
So we go bottom five. Nobody has reached second base tonight. 6-7-8-9 for the UC-Irvine Anteaters. Ripped to first, Clemens. Watch that one crawl up and get into that glove. One man down. The power of prayer. He's just looking around like, wow, are we ever going to get one?
Tell you that, it's one thing about Augie. He will try anything, absolutely anything. Quite a personality and obviously an incredible run.
Ball.
He told us a great story earlier this morning when he was interviewed after the 1956 season. A season in which the Longhorns finished last. He was asked, he said, coach, do you understand that you finished the bottom of the conference? And he said, no, I didn't. This one is hit to right field and it's going to stay in the park. He said, no, I didn't realize that. And then he was sort of discussing the 56 season and said, there's not a lot I can do about 56, but how did the team do in 57? And the 57 team went to the College World Series. And this team finished last year, and lo and behold, as he raised his arms in the meeting we were having with him and said, we're in the College World Series.
Well, 1 year can do.
Those are championships. The five of them, three of them with Cal State Fullerton and two with the Longhorns of Texas.
Yep.
Given how difficult it is to get back here, given their ages, you do wonder if this is maybe the last time you see a matchup like this at the College World Series. Must be two outs. Oh, there is, and that's why we got ourselves another hit. Take a look at the guys that have played and coached now here this year in the College World Series. Five guys, five of the eight teams. That is incredible.
Yeah. Dan McDonald back at the Citadel. That was the year everybody needed the Citadel hat. That was the hot hat. Brian O'Connor, Virginia Cavs 2-0 at this point. Mike Bianco, catcher on that 1989 LSU team when Ben McDonald was on the mound.
One foot in the batter's box now.
So thank what do you, you think that is? Success breeds success? Well, that's just that's a high number. Five of the eight played here and now are coaching here.
Yeah, I think that's a large part of it.
Ball.
Make no doubt about it. Either they just love baseball. They could talk baseball. They're fun to be around with their stories, and now they're sort of, you know, pearls of wisdom that they over the years have come up with and really really believe in. And listening to Augie talk about his team and getting them to be men as opposed to college students, some of the things that they did to accomplish that, seeing them grow from, I think he said, you know, boys, immature kids, wild bunches to what they are now. Real good feeling of satisfaction that Garrido's enjoyed.
I mean, the reality is, even as high as the talent level is here, the guys that are in each dugout, if one of them makes a significant living playing the game of baseball, that's still beating all the odds.
Right.
So the impact that these guys have on it, yeah, baseball's the vehicle. It makes a huge difference. But it's what you get out of it, what it allows you to do when you move on.
Three-two. Alcantara is on first. Justin Castro on the ground, too short. Still nobody to second base.
He's out.
We are through five, and we have bagels on the board. Second scoreless game through five in the 2014 College World Series. We had one in the previous 20 years. About 8:30 here in the Heartland, 9:30 on the East Coast, 6:30 out west, where the Irvine fans are watching intently as they hope their team can move on here in the College World Series, avoid elimination. Ole Miss and TCU will do the same thing tomorrow night at 8 o'clock Eastern time. Glad to have you along. I'm Carl Ravitch, along with Kyle Peterson, Jessica Mendoza down in the field, providing the interviews and her insights as we begin the top of the sixth inning. In a 0-0 ball game, second time we've seen it here in the College World Series through five. We had one of those in the previous 20 seasons. But a real good conversation with Damani Leach, the chairman of the NCAA championships, and the ballpark and the effect that it's having on the game and the viewers and the people in the stands and all those things. And seemed to be encouraged. Certainly having Kyle be encouraged is important because he's as close to the college baseball game as everybody, that certain things are at least being discussed. After we had that discussion, the Minnesota head baseball coach John Anderson, who was once a member of the baseball committee and worked on the design of this ballpark, said the stadium, he acknowledged the stadium probably would have been built differently if the impact of the new bat standards had been known during the planning stages. I think the wind is the one thing that that you really needed some local expertise on.
Yeah, that one, I mean, it just kind of surprises me. I mean, it's the summer. It's blown out of the south for the last 500 years.
But
at any rate, I mean, that's where we're at now. So I did like what we heard. I like what we heard, and I'm looking forward to seeing the new baseball be put in play. Man, I'm almost sneaking a few of them in right now. I don't think anybody'd say anything. We've got him. I'm holding him. Flip it down to Tony Walsh.
All of a sudden, we'd have four home runs in the game, and people are like, what the heck happened?
You got to throw it back. That's the only one we got.
Two starters have been pitching very well tonight. Evan Menorino about to throw a 70th pitch here in the sixth inning. Been terrific. Doesn't even seem to have broken a sweat yet.
Brooks Marlowe is the top of the order, and that is a great pitch. Breaking ball inside corner. And he is gone. Six strikeouts, I should say, for Manarino. For more coverage of the College World Series, including interactive brackets and highlights, go to NCAA.com. Well, the power of prayer Augie Garrido talked about doesn't seem to be kicking in just yet.
Need to be a little bit more specific within the prayer.
Ben Johnson to be followed by Mark Payton.
I'm ready to go now. I might have had the best burger I've had in the last 5 years. It was outstanding.
That the way that you went through that, and it wasn't very fast. It was like a steak on a bun.
That was an experience. The buddy's over at the Blatt taking care of us tonight. You get the daily double over there. You get the Blatt, which has great food, and then you got Zesto down below. A little bit of everything.
The vanilla milkshake on a nut like this is heaven.
There we go.
Right field camera high up there too. Down the line, fair ball. And Ben Johnson can fly. So he goes to second. If that gets by the left fielder, be careful. Johnson will go to third base and he will be in there. Fastest runner on the team took advantage of the play out there in left field by Adam Alcantara. And the furthest anyone has gone tonight, third base for the Longhorns.
But here's that athleticism, and it starts just with the power and the swing. It's hooked in a spot that even Taylor Sparks, the 6'4 third baseman, can't get to. Now down the line, and this is at ball two. And line, it's just not easy to get a good handle on it. Now Alcantara couldn't. That was a double, and with the bobble, turns into a triple. Great speed by Johnson. 21 stolen bases on the year. That speed allows him to go second to third when that ball was bobbled.
You're making sure that he stepped on first base, and guess what? He didn't. The Anteaters appealed at first base, and Ben Johnson, believe it or not, is called out. That's a great call. He stepped right over it.
Pretty good work, Scott Irby. That is really good work. Scott Irby, the first base umpire.
I think you got to give Connor Spencer a lot of credit. That is generally the first baseman's role, and lo and behold, had he not picked up on that, it's 1-0 Texas.
Wow. Yeah, that's assist Spencer right there. So watch your left foot touches. Right foot touches. Watch your left foot too. And the head of Connor Spencer is right down on it.
Give him credit. He may have saved the game.
Wow.
Ben Johnson out on an appeal play at first. Now you really got to wonder about Augie's relationship with the man upstairs. So we pray for
he get me that close.
Ball. Trace Barrera, back-to-back hard-hit balls, which is something we haven't seen. But here we are again with a man on with two outs. You're gonna have to change the mindset, you know. Just go to the plate thinking there are two outs, because everybody seems to hit the ball.
Yeah.
That's one you got to kind of circle and remember as this game unfolds. You had a man on third base and he was called out for missing first, and then the next guy up, Mark Payton, delivers a single.
Yeah, you get your best hitter up with one out. Look at the eyes. See Augie's eyes go back to Scott Irby. Was the right call.
And it wasn't an egregious miss, but he missed it. Breaking ball in for a strike, 1-1. I just think that's just such a great lesson, though, for first basemen
you know, growing up, it's your job. If that ball is an extra base hit, keep an eye on the base runner. Make sure he steps on first base. Really heads up play by Connor Spencer. On the ground to third. Look to second, throw to second for the force out.
Well, look like Ben Johnson's going to be standing on third base with one out. The problem is he missed first base. But the left eyes of Connor Spencer, the first baseman, looking straight down on it, and a great call by first base umpire Scott Irby. He got it right, and we're still scoreless.
Wondering?
To the bottom of the sixth in the elimination game. Texas UC Irvine still tied at zero. How about what we've seen on the mound so far tonight? Evan Manorino, the left-hander, who coming in, we had said, more of a control guy, throws to contact. He's done that, but at times has done a great job of expanding the zone. Fastball on both sides, a little breaking ball and a changeup that you saw right there. And really a similar approach just from the right side from Chad Hollingsworth. These guys are pitching 85 to 87 miles an hour, so it's not that they're just blowing it by guys, but what they are doing is getting ahead and getting ahead early. Look at the walk numbers. Combined one walk between the two up compared to 10 strikeouts. Both have been outstanding so far.
So the top of the order for Texas provided some excitement as Ben Johnson had what he thought was going to be a double and an error on third. He got called up for missing first. Now top of the order for Irvine, and Sparks lifts this one towards the Texas dugout, and it gets into the second row over there. Got to think, given the limited hitting so far by both of these teams, that if you're going to make some noise, it's going to be with the top of the order. And Sparks, certainly, who came in hitting 469 in this tournament, 15 for 32, is capable of doing that. He's 0 for 2 tonight. 400 in the College World Series.
Ball.
Could very well be playing for the Cincinnati Reds in the not too distant future. Work on cutting his strikeouts down a little bit, but good power, great athlete. Hits that one hard to third. Good job over there by Gerwitz as the ball came up on him and he throws out Sparks. Another day means another day closer to Team USA playing in the World Cup. Coverage continues Thursday, triple header, 11:30, Colombia, Ivory Coast, and then at 2:30, Uruguay will take on England. At 5:30, Japan against Greece, the 2014 FIFA World Cup presented by Adidas, Thursday on ESPN. All games live on Watch ESPN. Soccer fans surprised to see Spain exit from the World Cup today. Good pitch, 0-2.
They didn't just get clipped either.
Nope, they were bludgeoned. That was like two in a barbecue there for them. Get in, get out. USA next plays on Sunday. It really hasn't been said, but most people believe that Altidore is not going to come back until at the earliest, very late. Safe. Casey Clemens had it, snow coned it, popped out.
And Hinojosa, this one just a little bit low off the bat. It looks like it's two quick outs in this inning. Hinojosa's going to charge it, then make the throw off the run, and just low. Casey Clemens tries to go get it. You could see just didn't hit in the pocket of that glove. Climbed all the way up his hand. Not enough time to get it. Rabago's on there with one out for Irvine's best hitter.
Connor Spencer. Give the error to Hinojosa on the throw to Clemens. A rare base runner with one out. Spencer, left center, carrying, going back. It's the left fielder who cuts in front, Ben Johnson, and he throws it back in. Mark Payton and Ben Johnson both went after it, and it ended up Johnson making the catch.
Had my eyes on Payton, and when I saw Payton couldn't get there, just assumed that ball would fall down, but you forget about the speed out in left field with Ben Johnson. And he can run with anybody on the field. Good route by Johnson, calls it off right at the last minute. Another ball that's hit well by Spencer. He's really tried to use that side of the field. Singled earlier, and that time drove it in the gap.
You look at the outfield for Texas. Ben Johnson, two errors all year. Peyton, one. Colin Shaw, one. McClanahan to right. Shaw won't get there. Rabago is doing a lot of base running for somebody who's not really moving anywhere on the bases as he heads back to first. But he was at third base. He had gotten nearly to second base on that high fly to left. He's not a base stealer to begin with, but he's definitely not stealing a base now. Yeah. This will be a good Texas team next year, too. Really, with the exception of Peyton, all the guys are eligible to come back next year.
Offensively, they are young, very young. Get Hollingsworth back, just a sophomore we see on the mound tonight.
Could see Clemens in the rotation. The development of college baseball players, and Kyle, you can speak to this. It's amazing. You look at some of the numbers of the kids when they were freshmen, and then when they were sophomores, and how they really do develop. I mean, you can hit on a few of them, and they can take off. This one's going to get out of play.
Well, I think a lot of it, too, is you get guys just a chance. A lot of these guys are two-sport, three-sport athletes, and now you're coming in, you're focusing on one thing. You're lifting the entire year. You're working in, you know, some great environments to where you're given every opportunity to succeed. And these kids are putting on weight, and good weight, in a hurry. And not everybody comes in at a freshman looking like Clemens and Barrera. I mean, those kids are, they're big to start.
Great example of that was Crone last night, TCU. He's about 285 out of high school, and now he's about 245 and just muscle. And if you watched him last night, as much as we focus on center field, the first base play has been very good too here at the College World Series. This one, wow, stopped by the catcher remarkably. Rabago down to second base.
And that's the only thing Barrera can do right there too. There's no chance you can block that ball just given where it was, and he just about gloved it cleanly. Watch him get out there. Anyway, that got his mask.
Yeah. He matched it cleanly.
Just about masked it cleanly. Anything you can just to keep it in front, but the minute Rabago saw that ball going down, he was off. So now runner in scoring position, 2-2 count with McClanahan. The catcher is hitting above 300 with a chance here.
Looking for his first hit at the College World Series. He has struck out five times. This is technically our first runner in scoring position. And he'll stay in scoring position. And now he will leave scoring position. McClanahan strikes out. The road to Omaha paved with zeros tonight, 0-0 through six.
These sounds going down in a nowhere town underneath the wide open sky.
Howdy, Connie. Go Rebels!
Okay, we're ready.
Let's stand above, get it going early.
Don't make it again!
No.
Thank you very much for watching the College World Series. The field looked like this, as you can see, all south of really Louisville and Irvine. Nothing in the north. Big Ten country, Seattle, Oregon. None of them got here. And three teams from Texas. So all eight of those schools had their flags flying high. A couple of sank because their chances sank with them. Louisville and Texas Tech, 0-2 and out. Which one will be lowered tonight, Texas or UC Irvine? If you're looking for any number other than zero, you're going to have to keep looking. When will somebody break through? When will somebody get into scoring position? When will somebody put something together?
C.J. Hinojosa, the shortstop for Texas.
Ball down.
Like to see a leadoff guy get on, and then maybe you can get a sacrifice, move somebody along, get a stolen base.
You'll see some action if a leadoff guy gets on for either side.
2-0, Hinojosa, this one is deep. Deep to left field. Back goes Alcantara. It's gone! The first home run of the College World Series, 2014. Maybe Augie revisited that conversation.
Round two. Round two on the prairie. This ball is absolutely hammered. A cut fastball that stays right on the inside part of the plate. But now for Hinojosa, third time that he had seen Mannarino, and this one just didn't quite get in enough. Hands out in front. That one he absolutely knew. Now that is a no-doubter. First home run, and no chance that was staying in the ballpark. 1-0 Hawaiians.
And he got a standing ovation from not only the Texas fans, but every fan here at TD Ameritrade who's just been waiting to see a ball leave the building. And it comes off the bat of a guy who has been red hot in the NCAA tournament, hitting over 400 when the night began. 414. How about it? C.J. Hinojosa with a home run. And that really is the place you got to hit it. You got to pull it, and he hit it to the second wall of the bullpen.
Hey, let's build off of that, Larry. What do you say? Come down the floor.
And there was no appeal. He actually stepped on first base, second base, third base, and home. Damian Leach, the NCAA championship chairman, did not run into the booth and say, see, guys, you can hit home runs.
Told you.
Damani, I should say, did not run into the booth to tell us that. But I think just a sigh of relief for Texas and everybody else involved. That, should we ask, you didn't throw the ball down with the seams thing, did you? You have it still, right?
Yeah, right here.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Because that was hammered.
The other thing, too, that I think is going to be interesting is just to see how pitchers handle the seams, because it is a little bit different feel. I mean, for college, could you use those raised seams? A little bit easier to get your finger through a breaking ball. I think with the lower seams, you see maybe even a little bit more velocity. There he is.
Damani, you got one.
Good spot.
Great spot. I guess given what we saw with Crone the other night and where that ball went, this thing is just hammered.
It is. I think part of it, too, third time around. And so that little fastball in that had surprised the right-handed hitters from Texas the first two times around, that time it's not surprising. They've seen the movement on that pitch. Just kind of fell all the way in. And because it's mid-80s, plenty of time for Hinojosa to get spun on it. But all that being said, that went about 30 feet further than any ball has to left field yet.
I want to remind everybody that the world's best female golfers, after the men were in Pinehurst, it's now the ladies' chance. North Carolina, they'll compete in the second major championship of the year. U.S. Women's Open Golf Championship, Thursday. First round action at 3 on ESPN2, live on Watch ESPN. All the biggest and youngest names in the world of women's golf, from 11 years young to older, will be in Pinehurst. Look forward to seeing that. Evan Mannarino was outstanding, 6 1/3. He gave up just the one run, the home run, 5 hits, and he will leave the game. And now it becomes about the mustache. Evan Brock comes on. Seven Ks and a walk, 102 pitches, did exactly what Mike Gillespie wanted them to do.
Yeah, you walked into this one, said Manarino's going to pitch into the seventh to give up one run. You would take that every time. And so now they'll go to Evan Brock, who has now pitched in all three games that UC Irvine has played here in Omaha. Started throughout most of the season, but Brock so far here in Omaha has come out of the bullpen all three times. Best stash in Omaha?
Without question, the fullest.
Yes.
I mean, there's no doubt you could look at that and say, wow, why did he put that on before the game? But that's been, he's been carrying that since he got here. Donnie Baseball, Dan Quisenberry, Goose Gossage, Gorman Thomas, some of the most famous mustaches in baseball. Look at the great Vuk, Pete Vukovich, Raleigh Fingers with his famous curl at the end, and the shooter Rod Beck.
Uh-oh.
And this is what happens. Anteaters transporting mustache on stick. That's a that's unfortunate.
No, that's extremely fortunate. That's an idea. And one worth visiting.
Someone in the truck suggested it looked like Wyatt Earp. No comment. It's like the UC Irvine guy after the assessment of the line. Yeah, kind of did.
I nodded.
Not a bad one. Sure. I get it.
Uh-oh. It's catching on.
Yep. There you go, Jess.
Thanks. I don't know.
Anteater Nation.
Good luck. Yeah. Should I go for it?
Only like that. 0-2, ground ball, third baseman Sparks across the diamond for the out.
He's out.
You know, since Jess is there, what was sort of the emotion in the dugout after a ball actually cleared a wall, Jess?
It's not just the dugout, guys. The entire stadium erupted, and everyone running back. I want to see it again. I want to see it again. Did it really happen? I mean, definitely you could tell everyone letting out a big exhale, waiting for that first home run.
Damani Leach, the NCAA managing director, tweeted out a pretty simple, finally, a home run.
I saw him going to the phone right away.
Yeah. Makes the popcorn go down a little easier. I guess given the way that the ball flew tonight, I don't think it's that far off. Although tonight the wind is not howling like it usually does, but I just don't think it's that far off. Rabago called off by the left fielder. Adam Alcantara came right in over his shoulder to make the catch.
It's been over 100 innings since we've seen a home run, but not any longer. 116, you're going to race it. That's a no doubt off the bat. A CJ hit a host of the shortstop, just his second of the year, but that enough to give Texas a 1-0 lead. Stretch time.
Welcome back, everyone, to ESPN's coverage of the NCAA College World Series presented by Capital One. That doesn't say peace. I don't know what does. It's been very peaceful and quiet here, although rocked by a home run, the first of the 2014 College World Series. Our brackets look like this. Texas up 1-0 over UC Irvine. The winner stays alive. The loser goes home. Ole Miss and TCU tomorrow night, Thursday, 8 Eastern time. Looking forward to hearing Kyle do that broadcast as well. John Shambi, Aaron Boone, Jamie Sire. This one to short. Positioned beautifully.
Yes,
hit a host.
Did.
Right. I think they had a scouting report on Jonathan Munoz. They played that beautifully.
And it pinched up the middle. Hinojosa had to take about two steps. Watch where he starts. That's probably a good 8 to 10 steps to the second base side where Hinojosa is usually going to line up. Instead, it's one quick step to his left. Prizer. Tough for him not to throw that ball in about the 10th row right now after what he just did, but just flipped it over in time.
Yeah, who knows how this whole thing unfolds, but imagine if that was the only one hit. How about being the only guy to homer during an entire College World Series?
Statue.
Ball.
2-0, Grant Palmer. And he's done such a good job of it all night long. Chad Hollingsworth's sole mission is to try to keep people off base and throw strikes. Pours that one in there at 84 miles an hour.
93 pitches from Hollingsworth. Remember, this just his second start of the year. First start went complete game. This time, looks like he's going to give it a run, too.
Out of play, 2-2. Pretty famous names on the team, Clemens. Lucas Schiraldi is also on the Texas team. He, of course, the son of Calvin Schiraldi. Schiraldi and Clemens played together for the Red Sox. And a run on beach balls out there. Back up the middle. Hinojosa to his left. Two down.
He's out.
Ball hitting about the exact same spot, but this time Hinojosa playing normal depth and positioning. Watch him circle around this one, too. So first step off the bat, looks like it might have a chance to get there, but surrounds it. Time to set the right foot. It's decent.
If you like 15 and two-thirds with no earned and 8 Ks, that would qualify as decent.
It's got to be 85% fastballs. But it's just, here it comes. It's 84 to 86. And until you force me to do something else, I'm not going to do it.
And the whole squaring up concept of just getting the barrel of the bat to the ball doesn't appear to be very deceptive. It doesn't appear to have a lot of movement on it. But they just haven't squared up many balls at all. The 0-2. Nope. Ball. Location, location, location. He's got 5 strikeouts tonight. I know he doesn't throw hard, but they got to feel really good about the numbers we just showed in the biggest stage.
Oh, absolutely. Stage he took in the regionals was huge. Do or die game against Texas A&M goes complete game to beat him there. And the other thing this does, too, I mean, first of all, you're going to win today. But secondly, it saves the bullpen. They get a day off tomorrow. Gonna have to face a Vanderbilt team that's absolutely loaded, but Texas should have Nathan Hornhill there, or excuse me, Nathan Thornhill, their ace on the hill, and he's been unbelievable this year.
1-2, Hinojosa, the home run hitter. Favorite players, Derek Jeter, and it makes the Jeterian-like throw across the diamond.
Pretty good inning there.
And he's already come up with a home run. We're through.
Jeterian.
It's an adjective. Jeterian.
The NCAA College World Series is presented by the Quicksilver Card from Capital One. Earn 1.5% cash back on every purchase. And in part by Lowe's. Lowe's, never stop improving.
The 2014 College World Series with Kyle Peterson, Jess Mendoza, Texas up 1-0 over UC-Irvine out of the Big West. Only 3 hits for Irvine. And they'll get a couple of more chances as the home team tonight, batting in the 8th and the 9th. A home run from C.J. Hinojosa, the first home run of the 2014 College World Series in the 7th inning is the difference in this one. Zane Gerwitz, the number 9 hitter, and then back to the top of the order for Augie Garrido's Longhorns. Back up this way. One of the things Augie Garrido was talking about to us is the way a team recovers. He talked about we were 6 in the country, went 2-7 in the conference, beaten by TCU, Oklahoma State, lost during the week to Rice. And what he saw from his players was the ability to recover.
And he talks about that. Baseball is obviously a game of failure. How you rebound and recover from that.
Ball.
He's loved what he's seen from his players and the methods by which he has helped them grow, not exactly conventional. He got into all sorts of CrossFit training, military exercises. And what happened was you had some of the senior leaders like Peyton and others, and it began to sort of flower. Everybody else got involved.
The beauty of Augie is he is not conventional in whatever he does.
3-2 to Gerwitz. This one is lifted to left center field. Castro's under it. One man down in the eighth. Soccer fans, we know you're out there. ESPN's coverage of the FIFA World Cup continues on Thursday. Triple header, 11:30 a.m. Eastern Time, Colombia and Ivory Coast. Then at 2:30, Uruguay will take on England, Japan, and Greece. Wrap things up. That's Thursday, ESPN. All games live on Watch ESPN. Our game took us so deep last night. Got a chance to see the Brazil contingent with last call. Yeah. They get very comfortable out there. It'd be a Kyle Peterson show. A lot of no sock, you know, shirt.
No sock guy.
Yeah, shirt kind of, you know, one or two buttons.
Two button down doesn't really work for me.
That's not working.
Nope.
Oh,
but the no sock. Golf shirt.
Go with that.
No sock.
Kick your feet up.
Shades.
Eat a burger.
Yeah, you've definitely proven you could do that. I never seen. It's rare you see skills. Somebody enjoy it so much.
Gotta know your skills, Ravi. It was a G-tarian job of eating a burger.
Yeah, I'm still trying to figure out what those skills are. Hey, if you're scoring at home,
got a little game tracker going here.
Or in the stands. Tweet Kyle. He likes to get the tweets. This one is down the line and just foul. Brooks Marlow almost had extra bases.
Just hooks a little bit too much and just caught it a little bit too far out in front of home plate. Marlow, the leadoff hitter, hit it hard out to the shortstop earlier in this ball game. That time about 3 feet away from a double.
Brock's been brutal. I mean, he just doesn't allow guys on base.
No, and it's great, too, because the role's a totally different role. Coming into this College World Series, 16 appearances, 16 starts on the year for Evan Brock. 3 appearances in the College World Series, and all 3 have come out of the bullpen.
Heat, 91. Marlow is gone. Talk about tweeting. And you think Garrido and Gillespie text each other? Think Augie's into the texting thing, Gillespie?
I would bet Augie is, yeah.
Yeah. Tweeting?
I don't know. I don't know if he's tweeting a whole lot.
Old school doesn't mean that you can't relate to the new school way of thinking. Gillespie was telling us great stories about this UC-Irvine team and how they have created their own Saturday Night Live skits, to which he's been the butt of many of the jokes. And he can laugh right along with him. Get the sense, if you're wearing an eater's jersey, if you're an anteater, you got to be able to wear it. You got to be able to give it and take it. This ball is hit to left. Back goes Alcantara, but he'll have room and make the catch. So another clean inning for Mr. Brock. The horns are out, and they're getting closer to moving on. All right, boys and girls, tomorrow night here at the College World Series, 2 teams are hoping to avoid elimination. Ole Miss, fresh off their walk-off win against Texas Tech, facing a TCU team anxious for a rematch with Virginia after they lost in 15 last night. Coverage of the 2014 College World Series presented by Capital One continues tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern Time.
on ESPN. Kyle, let's talk about the probables tomorrow night. Tyler Alexander looks for his 11th win on the season. He'll be opposed by Sam Smith.
How is that when your number three starter is a 2.16 ERA? And that's what Tyler Alexander's done this year for TCU. Top ERA in the country. So the Frogs are very deep. Sam Smith has had a great year for Ole Miss as well. I think this one, too, the question is, can the Ole Miss offense get going? It's had some challenges the first two times out. Not going to get any easier against that TCU staff.
Six outs away from elimination, Adam Alcantara bats in the bottom of the eighth. 8-9-1 due up this inning. Ooh. No strike call for Chad Hollingsworth, and a pitch that looked pretty good. The count goes to 1-1. Boy, anytime a hitter has leaned in, it seems like that's been the trigger for Tony Walsh to call a strike. And working quickly, 1-2, they can't get out of the way of that one. So a leadoff man on, down 1-0, and a chance now for Irvine. Travis Duke, the righty, Morgan Cooper warming up. Down to Jess.
Guys, I spoke to Skip Johnson before the game, and John Curtis, their probable closer in most nights, is woke up this morning under the weather. He said he'd probably be a question mark, most likely not be able to go, but he said, you know, I have so much confidence in the rest of this bullpen. It's like throwing all their names in a cowboy hat, and I could pick anyone and feel pretty good about it.
Not just a hat.
Cowboy hat.
Throw them all in a cowboy hat.
Of course.
Like it. There are five guys in that Texas bullpen have over 20 appearances. Comes Skip Johnson.
Big time strategy going on here with Johnson. Gillespie talking to his hitter. For more coverage of the College World Series, including interactive brackets and highlights, head to NCAA.com. Castro tried earlier tonight to get a sacrifice bunt down. He couldn't do it. He has 23 sacrifice hits on the season. And amongst the leaders. And they would love to get a man in scoring position with Taylor Sparks coming up next. Nobody out. Remember that game against Texas the first time through? They scored three runs in that eighth inning. And here we are. The eighth inning has really been the magic inning at the College World Series this year.
One foot in the batter's box.
What Hollingsworth doesn't want to do is walk him.
It's a spot in the past where Mike Gillespie's got a little bit more aggressive and taking a bunt off, maybe putting a hit and run on. Nine-hole hitter a little bit tougher with Castro. Looks like he's keeping it on.
He got it down. Hollingsworth bare hands. Throws to first for the out, but
he's out.
Alcantara moves into scoring position and really the biggest spot of the game now. Taylor Sparks, best hitter on UC-Irvine at the plate with a chance to knock in a tying run.
I thought this might be the time that you would see the move on the mound, because now the fourth time that Sparks has seen Hollingsworth. Sparks pretty elite talent, and for Hollingsworth, he's not a big swing and miss guy. You let a guy with elite talent see 84, 85 mile an hour fastball time after time, and I would see if Hinojosa's coming in just to give the arms a little bit more time.
All right, so we talked about this at the top if you weren't with us. The Irvine offense has scored literally in two innings, the second inning against Vanderbilt and the eighth inning against Texas. The other 23 innings, they haven't scored. Same number of hits, but the runs they scored came in just two innings.
Well, and this same inning against Texas was what gave them the lead. Three runs, and that led to an Irvine opening round win over Texas. Now a pinch runner out at second base for the Eaters.
Ryan Cooper goes in. A little surprised that they're letting Hollingsworth pitch here as well, assuming he is once the umpire gets behind home plate. .109 pitches. Two fresh arms in the bullpen. Sparks struck out. required a web gem in center field from Peyton his second time up. And he grounded to third his last time up. They're going to pitch to him.
And the matchup's advantage Sparks, I think.
One and one. Cooper out there at second base, who came in as a pinch runner, has appeared in 46 games. He started 19 of them. He's only stolen three bases in four attempts. He borrowed Evan Brock's mustache, too, apparently.
That's talent.
To second base. Marlowe's under it. Wynn got it. He makes the play. Huge out.
That's the biggest out of the ball game right there for Hollingsworth, because Sparks is a guy that if he catches it to left has a chance to give Irvine a 2-1 lead. First pitch fouled straight back. That one got under it. About as high as you can hit a ball. Marlowe stayed with it for the second out.
Chris Rabago, the shortstop. Has ended a home run this season. Hinojosa, the shortstop for Texas, has homered tonight. So we'll see if the other shortstop can try to bring a run in for Irvine. ...68-mile-an-hour offering just came in there that Rabago swung over. Way outside, way off the base, throw down. Marlowe cut in front of Hinojosa to intercept the ball, fearing perhaps it was headed towards center field, but Hinojosa was there. Cooper wants to get that big secondary lead, so if it is hit into the outfield, he could score. Back up the middle. Hinojosa there. He's been flawless at shortstop tonight, and he's got that home run. And guess who's coming up when we come back in the top of the ninth inning? Mark Payton, Trace Barrera, and CJ Hinojosa. Three outs away, Texas.
Welcome back to Omaha. Let's take a look at our Capital One impact performance, something that has been pretty much the impossible tonight. Hitting a home run in this park, CJ Hinojosa did it beautifully, went long. And this is how he did it. He was able to get his front foot down. Look at it open up. That allows his hands to stay back. But look at him clear his hips and get all of that momentum. Eyes down on the ball. That's what allowed him to put all of his force, all of that power into that home run. Big key is that he recognized that inside pitch first, so he could open up his hips and get all that power into what was a beautiful, beautiful swing, guys.
Thank you, Jess, and we appreciate that. Our Capital One Cup impact performance, the swing of Hinojosa, and we'll see him this inning. First, Mark Payton fouls one off. Ripped on the ground to first, fielded cleanly by Connor Spencer, and Payton, who'd been on twice, is retired.
That's a great breakdown from Jess. It's one thing, too, she talked about the front foot opening up. We were talking to Skip Johnson today about Trace Barrera back behind the home plate. One of the things that he had said is he gives Barrera the ability to call some pitches because he wants to see what hitters' feet are doing. And you can really only see that back behind home plate.
On the ground in the hole, caught over there, but there'll be no throw. Good range by Rabago, but Trace Barrera is on, and that brings up the guy that Jess just analyzed CJ Hinojosa.
Because of that, let's see if the approach is a little bit different this time with Hinojosa. Barrera this time fastball kind of pulls the length of the plate. Jhonber Rabago just to get to it, but there's no chance you're going to throw Barrera out right there. So Hinojosa back up this time with somebody standing on first base.
No play at first. Hinojosa actually squared to bunt. He's the home run guy. Come on. He's a home run hitter.
Could do it all.
If he hit one out, I want to see another swing at it, don't you?
Just trying to bring Sparks in at third base. Try to drive it by him.
Hinojosa hit one home run during the regular season. One.
Got one.
One of the last remaining raised seam baseballs. Connor Spencer's going to get a chance in the bottom of the ninth, the number three hitter, to lead things off for Irvine. Amazing how you get to be a little more careful with a guy that actually jumped one earlier as opposed to just pitching to him.
Isn't that true? I mean, the mindset on Hinojosa just entirely changes in one at bat.
Really good pitch. Yep. Really good pitch in there for a strike to even the count up at 2-2. UC-Irvine, one of the last in and a brutal road through the regionals and super regionals. Battling Texas here in the College World Series elimination game.
Got front side two from Brock. This had him jumping back there too. Front side from Brock and that head just stays right in the catcher's mitt.
This one's going to be playable. The center fielder Castro under it. Two men down. And the right fielder is Colin Shaw. He's got one of the six Texas hits tonight. Change up and he swings right on top of that one for a strike. Can't really overstate how important Hollingsworth's start was, especially given the news that Jess gave us earlier that John Curtis, their everyday closer, woke up feeling sick and really wasn't available tonight. 0-1 in the dirt. It gets by the catcher and down to second base goes Trace Barrera. He'll stay there. Tough pitch from McClanahan to handle. Going to bring Hollingsworth back out, try to get him his second complete game. Nine innings, two hits, no runs against A&M. He's got eight innings and three hits here.
Can't tell if they're heating it up or cooling it down. If they're cooling it down, that's it. But they're trying to keep that arm warm. We'll see Hollingsworth in the ninth, 115 pitches. But he hadn't walked one. And I think that's the key. The hit batsman you thought maybe would come back to get him in the last inning, but pitched himself out of a jam by getting Sparks in a giant spot.
Shaw with an RBI opportunity here on the ground to second. One hop to Palmer.
He's out.
To the bottom of the ninth, last chance for the Eaters and the best hitter
for Irvine. We'll lay things off. 3-4-5 due up for Irvine. Connor Spencer, 360 on the year. They'll lead it off.
That's TD Ameritrade as Texas leads 1-0 going to the bottom of the ninth inning for UC Irvine. Texas starters this season, there have been a couple of complete games, Thornhill and Hollingsworth. Hollingsworth on the verge of trying to do that again. Vandy's already 2-0, Texas and Irvine. The winner will get a chance to play the Commodores. Virginia awaits the winner of Ole Miss TCU. You'll see that tomorrow night, Thursday, 8 o'clock Eastern time. So they're going to start the inning with Hollingsworth on the mound. And he's got to deal with the meat of the order. Spencer, McClanahan, and Munoz. McClanahan, though, struggling big time. A couple of strikeouts tonight. Munoz 0 for 3. Spencer with one hit. First pitch, and wouldn't you know it, the leadoff man gets on. Spencer sends a single into left field.
He can hit. And he can hit because he will use the entire field. It's the second time he's gone to left today for a single. And for Spencer in that spot, you know, there's a pretty good chance you're going to get a first pitch fastball because that's what Hollingsworth has leaned on the entire day. First pitch fastball laced to left. Leadoff man on for Irvine in the ninth.
Jerry McClanahan is your cleanup hitter. That doesn't mean that he will not sacrifice. He's got 5 sacrifice hits this year. They'd love to get Spencer in a scoring position. He bunts it foul.
Well, Chad Hollingsworth in a time to where Texas needed a starter. Game 7 in the regional, they're going to play A&M again. Started using everybody else to really go argue his case, and one of the biggest was Nathan Thornhill, the ace of this staff, to go to Skip Johnson and say, hey, Thornhill wants the ball, Hollingsworth wants the ball, we think this is the right guy. And Skip had a discussion with Augie and said, all right, let's do it. He didn't have a start up until that point. Goes complete game against A&M, and now 3 outs away. If he can get himself out of a jam, going back to back.
Ball.
1-1. Yeah, the great part about that story is Hollingsworth gets in touch with his pitching coach, Johnson, and texts him, I want the ball. And Johnson says, I'm not going to make that decision until I talk to Augie. And then, like airplanes at LaGuardia, like 7 other guys start pleading the case for Hollingsworth.
Called in the lobbyists.
This one, center field, hit well, but right at Mark Payton, who's there to make the catch. And McClanahan slaps his hands in frustration. He got good metal on that. But one man down and no advancement to the runner. Jonathan Munoz set to come up, the designated hitter. Hollingsworth's 119th pitch was his last. They're going to go to the left-hander. And he should get a standing ovation for his effort. 8 1/3. The lefty coming in for Texas. Travis Duke. Hollingsworth will exit in line for the win.
Once.
Just listen to the ovation that Hollingsworth got coming off the mound from the fans and then his teammates.
Kid, a key reason why Texas is still playing at this point, the outing that he had in the regionals and then what he did tonight, that'll get you a hug from Augie Garrido.
All right, Kyle, and now you focus on the Duke. Travis Duke, he retired all 5 he faced on Monday, picked up his first career save.
The Duke, I like it. Travis Duke coming on really primarily because he was standing in the box, and that's Jonathan Munoz. Lefty matchup guy with a really good curveball. 0.32 ERAs usually play pretty well. 21 hits and 28 in the third, but those 24 strikeouts are primarily in spots like this. Come in to face the left-hander. And that breaking ball down and away is what Munoz is going to handle in this at bat if he's going to end up on base.
Longhorns 37-1 when leading after eight innings. But again, this is not the usual closer. John Curtis woke up ill today. Lefty on lefty with a curveball. The left side of the infield has to be ready for a ground ball. Only a couple of stolen bases for Connor Spencer.
So that first pitch key, now it really allows Duke to go to work with the breaking ball. Get out in front 0-1. Now we'll try to expand that zone with the curveball.
Oh. Another close one there.
Fastball, fastball.
Longhorns two out away from a date with Vanderbilt, trying to stay alive out of the loser's bracket here at the College World Series. Again, two steals for Connor Spencer. Likely not going anywhere. He certainly doesn't want to get thrown out here in the ninth inning, attempting a steal. We've already seen the great arm of Trace Barrera once. 1-2, and now you've really set up a position to throw a breaking ball or two.
A three straight fastballs, and the deception from Duke is really good too. Does a good job of hiding that ball back behind him. Just 86 mile an hour fastball, but 1-1 count. I think Munoz in the mind, you're thinking you're going to get a breaking ball at some point, but it's been three straight fastballs to get to a 1-2 count. See what Barrera does here.
Risking the breaking ball, obviously, as the ball bounces in the dirt, gets away from the catcher, and the runner at first advances to second. Call strike three. What a pitch.
I mean, this is where he wanted to go. It's not a strike, called a strike, but a good job too. If you think you're gonna get that call from Duke, and that's what we see. I mean, most umpires, if you're gonna give ground, you're gonna give on the outside part of the plate, a good spot to throw it, because you will get that call sometimes, and a giant strikeout right there for Duke.
Yeah, the ball call was a lot closer to the strike than that one, but now the last chance. It's Grant Palmer. Swings and misses, and we've seen a lot of fastballs here from a guy known for throwing off-speed stuff. Travis Duke has retired all six men he's seen. College World Series, and he throws that one again over to first base.
You talked about things that happened late in the game, and Jerry McClanahan called on to bunt the first pitch of the at bat, and then they take the bunt off, and he hit it hard, just hit it right out to center.
One strike away.
Couldn't get Spencer out to second base.
Sandon Spencer here with two strikes.
I think I do it on this pitch.
Yeah.
This pitch you're probably going to see, just based on what we've seen to this point, some kind of an elevated fastball, which makes it much easier for Barrera to throw.
He's going. Right field, playable. Shaw. Texas wins. Longhorn stay in Omaha extended by a couple of days thanks to the H&H combination of Hollingsworth and Hinojosa. Home run from the shortstop there, wearing number 9, and 8 1/3 from Hollingsworth. Maybe the last time we see Augie Garrido and Mike Gillespie in Omaha together.
That's a pretty cool moment. Those guys have shook hands plenty on the field. You know that that's probably going through their minds a little bit right now, too.
Texas improves to 3-0 in elimination games. Friday, 3 o'clock Eastern time on ESPNU, Vandy and Texas. Ole Miss and TCU look forward to seeing that tomorrow night, 8 o'clock Eastern time. And a host of the hero tonight with a home run, Hollingsworth. Outstanding on the mound again. Don't forget to join us on ESPNU for our College World Series postgame show. SportsCenter follows right here. Look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Ole Miss TCU at 8. Final score, Texas 1, Irvine nothing. For Jess Mendoza, Kyle Peterson, and all the men and women behind the scenes, Carl Ravitch saying so long.